All right, hello everyone. This is Pandemic Horde's Mining and Null-Sec class. In this presentation, I'll be covering the basics of mining and Null-Sec, along with some of the ship's skills and mods used to mine ore, and some of the tips on how to be effective and stay safe in our systems while you're mining. All right, so some of you are here because you're completely new and you're interested in learning a little bit about mining. Some of you may already have a bit of experience under your belt and are looking to do some new things in EVE. Some of you elite bros, I know, have a searing hatred for mining because it has quite a bit of potential to be boring, but some of us have to do it. Mining's an important thing in EVE, and hopefully after going through this presentation, you'll be able to do it safely and make some decent amount of ISK along the way. But to cover the first things first, mining in general is really comparable to ratting. The amount of skill training needed and effort are very similar. The payoff is very similar as well, especially when you get into some of the larger ships like your mining barge or mining exhumers. And come November, you'll start to do mining capitals, which is going to be crazy, but that should be coming up in the next pat. Since we are in Null-Sec, since we are a Null-Sec-based corporation, we do have the benefit of getting Null-Sec ores, which I'll cover a lot more later. But the biggest benefit is that they do sell a hell of a lot better than high-sec ores and some of the low-sec ores. It's one of the safer professions in EVE, if you do it properly. I'm sure some people meet me with some contention on this, but if you stay somewhat aware of your surroundings, it is pretty hard to get blown up while mining. It's just a matter of paying attention and keeping your head on a swivel. And lastly, one of the most favorite aspects of mining in EVE for me is just the fact there is a low level involvement. I don't recommend somebody going completely AFK while mining, you know, compared to like people going completely AFK while ratting and stuff. But while mining, you can certainly, you know, hit up Netflix, do some binge watching, you know, surf the web, chat up comms, do whatever, drink heavily, take up alcoholism, all that. But to begin, some of the skill books you need are easy to find. I have provided some ventures to people that have pretty much all the skill books shown in this tab, except the mining exhumer, because those are kind of expensive. But if you don't have those yet, I can give you a quick rundown of what you'll need. First, you'll need to get a mining frigate skill book to get into your first ship, the Venture. It's a mining frigate. To get into it, you just have to level it to 1, but you want to level that to at least 3. And then you want to start working on mining, astrogeology, and industry. Those are the other 3 skill books to get you into the next level of mining ships, which is the mining barges. These actually increase your mining yield a lot, tremendously. And training into barges in particular can take roughly 5 to 7 days training, give or take, depending on what kind of implants you get. Beyond that, exhumers are your next mining ship. They're the step above mining barges, or you can essentially call them Tech 2 mining barges. These can take anywhere between 45 to 50 days to train, and they increase your yield in mining even further. It's kind of hard to estimate how much overall in volume per hour you can get, because the ships themselves do vary quite a bit. But they are the next step in mining. Beyond that, you have in the November patch, you'll actually be getting some of your larger ships like the Orca and the Rorqual, which I'll cover a little bit later. But the training time of those are a bit extreme. So after you train into your ships, you can actually do a little bit of a specialization in certain aspects of mining. Instead of just mining up regular ores, you've got a few different options. Ice harvesting is one. Gas harvesting. And if you spec into a special skill called deep core mining, you can actually gather something called Mercoxit. It's very rare. It used to be like really profitable. It's not as profitable right now, given the current market trends with it. But that's a thing. And finally, your drone skills. Mining drones are a thing, and they do exactly like their name. They little drones that'll mine for you. Also, it wouldn't hurt to train a little bit into your like light drone operations or medium drone operations, depending on what ships you fly, because you can actually use those as well to defend yourself. A lot of the mining barges and exhumers have drone bays that will help you in that regard. All right, so fitting your first ship to Venture, it's pretty easy. All you'll need is just a few really cheap mods. Your biggest one being your Miner Ones. These are actually your mining lasers. They do all your work. Essentially, you just lock onto an asteroid and click your Miner Ones, and they'll start harvesting. And as they cycle through, they'll gather ore. When the cycle finishes, whether you cancel it or it goes through its whole cycle duration, at that point it'll deposit ore into your hold. Some other things, you want to slap an afterburner or a micro warp drive, depending on what you have set up. Makes your ship go a little bit quicker. Throw a shield extender on there, make it a little bit harder to kill. Survey scanners, you can throw this in your mid slot, and it's helpful in that it'll scan down ores for you or asteroids, and they show you things like the range on an asteroid and how much ore is left in the asteroid itself. In your low slot, you can throw a mining laser upgrade into your ship, and those just give you a flat increase to your yield. You can, if you have a few low slots, you can actually install multiple mining laser upgrades, but they do suck up your CPU as a drawback. So you have to take that into account. Once you get out of your Venture and into your mining barge, the only real thing you need to know is that instead of mining lasers, like your Miner Ones and Miner Twos, you'll switch to something called strip miners. They are essentially just like mining lasers, except they have a really long duration or really long cycle time, and they bring in a lot more ore. They have a lot higher yield. And that's pretty much the basics when it comes to getting into your first ships. Once you've invested some of the necessary skills and you get your ships ready to fly, you can start mining. And if you're mining for a pandemic horde, there's a few things you need to know. The most important thing is that you want to join the local standing fleet. Standing fleet's sole purpose is to make sure everyone's aware of what's going on within the group of systems standing fleet covers. Mining while in standing fleet will give you a fast and accurate response to anyone being attacked by enemy players, being overwhelmed by rats, which are enemy NPCs, non-combat players, or just in general giving you a bit of a heads up on any enemy fleets or solo roam gangs entering your system, along with the intel channel, which is a completely separate channel, and we've set up. You can find those if you go to the Corp channel and click on the link there. So while you're in Standing Fleet, you'll see two posts that'll be used, and you'll need to remember these. These are important. They're the W's and the R's. So WWW is reserved for people being actively attacked by enemy players or enemy capsuleers. If you post those while you're being attacked, you should immediately follow up with what system you're in and who's attacking you, or specifically what ship they are attacking you in. 3 R's are meant solely for rats, the enemy NPCs, and if they're attacking you, if you're being overwhelmed by them. Just know that rats are a bit of a low priority. It doesn't hurt to throw it up in Standing Fleet if you are getting a little bit overwhelmed, but if you don't see a response, warp out. Warp to a safe spot. Just get yourself out of the way. Either there's an issue of the Standing Fleet is busy with something else, or there's just not enough people, or people aren't paying attention. Hopefully it's not the latter, but just be wary of that. All right, now once you're in Standing Fleet and you're ready to start mining, first thing you're probably going to ask yourself, if you are completely new to the game and new to mining in general, you're going to ask, where do I go to mine? There's two places you can go. There's two different type of asteroid fields, you can go. One is an asteroid belt. Belts orbit a planet within a system. Typically, the more planets you have within that system, the more belts that there are available. They contain ore that's common to the region and security status associated with it. So the lower the security system status, the higher the quality of ore and rareness that you'll see. Even though Pandemic Horde is a Null-Sec corp and we do have some of the lower security status systems, it is worth mentioning that asteroid belts are not as profitable as the other type of asteroid field. They're called clusters. Asteroid clusters are anomalies generated in a system that have a high industry index. Now, without getting too far into explaining what an industry index is or what ADMs are, because I'll actually cover a little bit of that later, just know you can easily see the index by hovering over the small chevron shield looking icon in the top left of your screen. If the industry index is high and some of our Horde directors have installed the necessary iHub mods, they'll actually generate these clusters. To see what clusters are available, you can click Alt-P to pull up the active anomaly screen within the little probe scanner menu that pops up. If you click on the little header group ID, you can actually sort for these sites called ore sites, which are the clusters themselves. I'll show you how many that there are. Now, typically, a higher industry index means that there are larger clusters that are available to you. If the system has, for example, like a level 5 industry index, and it has the appropriate iHub infrastructure installed, it will spawn the largest ore anomaly available. It's called the Colossal Asteroid Cluster, and those typically contain a lot of ore. They take very, very long to clear out, if they even get cleared out before reset. What's nice about these clusters, what actually makes them really profitable, is that they contain not only rare ores, but ores that aren't typically found within the systems and regions that you're in. They contain things like Bistot, Crocite, Arcanor, Mercoxit, the really rare ore. What's also nice about them is that they'll spawn different variants of ores. There's the 5% variant and a 10% variant of an ore. For example, like Arcanor, these typically will spawn in clusters. If you're in a system that has like a negative 0.1 rating, it'll likely only spawn Arcanor, just the base version of Arcanor. If you're somewhere between a negative 4 to a negative 7, or negative 0.4 and negative 0.7 rather, it'll spawn the 5% variant called Crimson Arcanor, which, what I mean by 5% variant, it'll actually process 5% more minerals than normal. And if you're in like a negative 0.8 system or lower, all the way down to negative 1.0, it'll spawn the 10% variant, which is called Prime Arcanor, which will reprocess in 10% more minerals than the base version. So one of the better benefits of mining in a cluster, typically we'll have clusters where a lot of mining is done, where we have the appropriate iHub infrastructure. And that's likely going to draw a whole bunch of other miners to those spots too. It's nice that if you're having a lot of miners around you, you kind of have that safety in numbers effect, especially when you're dealing with rats. You'll have people to help you clear out rats and keep you safe for longer, a longer amount of time. The exact opposite can also be said though, because say a fleet warps into your system and you're in one of these clusters and they see a whole bunch of miners just sitting there. That's kind of a big target on your back, essentially. But if everything's doing everything right, if they're looking at intel, they're paying attention to local, you'll likely receive well sufficient notice before they even get close to you. It'll give you plenty of time to warp off to a safe spot. So just keep that in mind. All right, since I've discussed what or where you need to mine, let's discuss what you need to mine. So you need to know that all ores will sell, but they do vary in price or a sell amount. Sometimes it's substantial. There are a few different ways to tell what you want to mine based on what you want to sell, and I'll discuss that here. Best way to look is look for any lucrative buy orders that might be on the marketplace. This should give you a good determination of what's going for what particular ore. If you're interested in having your ores actually benefit the corporation, benefit Horde, there are certain pilots within Horde. They'll post under our website, under the Horde Industrial Marketplace subforum. They have these things set up called buyback programs where they essentially buy all of your ore in bulk and give you a flat rate. And that flat rate is a bit of a competitive rate compared to other buybacks. You just kind of have to scope out which one sells the best. If you're actually interested in taking your ore to one of the trade hubs in the game, like Jita, and selling it there, you can actually look at a few websites. There's a place called Fuzzworks. I think it was actually produced by somebody in Horde. I could be wrong there. There's another website that I use, Sir Lestis's Ore Table. It'll actually give you a nice chart of all the ores currently being sold in some of the trade hubs like Jita, Dodixie, and just give you a nice chart to show what the going ISK rate is for certain ores and what's going up, what's going down, stuff like that. Now, it's worth mentioning that when I tell you what usually sells in EVE, given the nature of it, if it sells well now, it may not sell for shit later. And vice versa. If something sells like crap right now, it may sell actually really well later on. So everything that I say right now, take with just a little bit of speculation. Some of the best ores that sell are known as the ABC ores. These are your Null-Sec ores, Arcanor, Bistot, and Crocite. At the moment, Crocite does sell the worst. Very few people are mining that right now. But these are ores that are only mined in Null-Sec and contain some of the rarer minerals like Megasite, Mexilon, and Oxium that are used for ship production, mod production, stuff like that. In Null-Sec, there's a really rare ore called Murkoxite, which refines down to something called Morphite. You won't find these in asteroid belts. You'll likely only find them in ore anomalies. And they take a special skill to mine and a few special modules to mine. It's called deep core mining. What sucks about this, though, is that Mercoxit, you actually mine at a much slower rate than all the other ores in the game. So that sucks. But some of the non-ore mining sources, like I covered earlier, ice, it has a unique purpose. It's used as fuel for different things, like stations, citadels, sinos, jump bridges on Titans, all that stuff, or jump bridges in general, next to our passes. Gas, which you'll find the lucrative versions of gas only in wormholes. They're quite profitable in that they're used to create combat boosters, which are like space drugs. They increase certain attributes on your capsuleer. You can actually mine something called fullerite in gas sites. They're actually used to produce Tech 3 ships, which are kind of like notoriously overpowered right now. And they are a pain to manufacture just because of the fact you have to get to these gas sites. But they are quite profitable. Alright, so the alternative to just taking your ore, mining it, and selling it would be just refining it, actually taking it and processing it out to create minerals. One of the things you can do within our corporation, you can ask around for somebody that has what's, quote, perfect refining. Or to say it differently, they break down the ores at the highest rate. To do that, you need to have a lot of skills in refining. It's quite an extensive train to cover all the ores that are available in the game. But if you ask around, maybe somebody will even do it for you for free, which would be awesome. So keep that in mind. The obvious reason why you do want to do this, refine it down to minerals, is that you're actually wanting to create ships or mods, to do industry, essentially. But there might be some reasons why you still want to keep them as an ore, why you want to avoid refining them, if you aren't doing either of those. Ores are easier to move by default, or to ship around. Especially after you compress them. The fact that since it does take up less volume after you compress it than minerals makes it just infinitely easier to get it to where it needs to go and just have it be of some use to people who are doing industry. Another thing is that most ores actually don't contain just one mineral. They contain multiple minerals. One of those minerals may be a little bit lucrative, may sell really well, and then the other mineral in that ore may sell for crap, which kind of just lowers the overall value of your refining. Another thing to note, if you do compress your ores, which you can do in a citadel or a station, when you compress it, it actually turns it into a completely new item. So like say if you have Arcan ore and you compress it, you'll compress it down to something that's just literally called compressed Arcan ore. And since it has become a completely new item, you aren't going to be able to sell it to a buy order that has just Arcan ore. Somebody has to actually post up compressed Arcan ore on the market. So that's just one thing to be wary of. All right, so after you've been sitting in a cluster or belt, you've mined up enough ore to fill your ore hold. You're going to ask yourself, what do you do at that point? One thing you can do is you can just fly back to your station or citadel of choice and drop it off. If you have an industrial alt or a hauler alt, as they're called, you can have them sit next to you. Next to your mining ship, and you can just transfer your ore to them over time and then fill your hauler up that way. Industrial alts or industrial haulers, they have a lot larger ore holds, especially a Galente hauler called a Miasmos has a really, really big ore hold. It's kind of dedicated to hauling around ore specifically. The alternative to that is something called jet can mining. It's where you purposely jettison your ore into open space, and it'll create something called a jet can. Jet cans hold, I think, 27,000 cubic meters. They'll sit in space, and they'll last for about an hour, and then they'll disappear. They'll kind of expire. So if you're in something like a mining barge or an exhumer, and you're putting in a lot of ore over time, you can consider using jet can mining to just kind of efficiently keep yourself mining ore. It'll keep you from warping back to your citadel or station every time you fill up your ore hole. If you want to get real fancy, you can use something called a freight container. They're like really, really big jet cans. You have to anchor them in space prior to jettisoning anything. And then you can park your barge or exhumer right next to it. And as you're mining, you can just drop it into the freight container. Freight containers are huge. They hold up to 250,000 cubic meters. And they'll last for about 30 days, I believe. Now, I say all of this about jet can mining, but there's one really stupidly huge drawback to it. And that, or two rather, two big drawbacks. First one being anybody can go into your jet can and pull stuff out. So, God forbid, somebody in our corporation decides they want to steal your ore. They have a pretty easy way of doing that if you're jet can mining. We've had instances like that before. They usually do get addressed fairly quickly. Most of the time, it's just a new bean error. They didn't realize that that's something that they can't do. Sometimes it is a bit of a malicious intent. People just straight up stealing your ore. But that compared to that one drawback compared to the other, which is it literally takes just one shot to blow up a jet can, and literally everything in the jet can itself disappears. Everything gets blown up. And that sucks. All right, so that pretty much covers the basics. I'll give you a few tips and tricks on when you're mining in Null-Sec, what to look out for, and some things to keep in mind. The biggest one is that you can actually receive boosts while you're mining. You can get the assistance of other ships that increase certain aspects of mining through things called link mods, and they include things like just flat out increasing your yield, lowering your cycle duration on your mining lasers and strip miners, survey scan range, and a few others. In November, in this upcoming November, there will be a patch that will require these boosts, these boosting ships, to be on grid with you, which essentially means they just need to be in the same vicinity as you. Right now, you can actually park one of these ships next to a citadel, and it'll affect anybody in your fleet in that entire system. But coming November, they'll actually have to be next to you. And it's always best to ask around in fleet chat, say, you know, like, are there any boosts in such and such system? And if so, who's boosting? And I'll make sure to get the same squad or wing as you. Another pro tip, while you're mining, it's always best to bookmark whatever asteroid you'll be mining. The reason why, when you warp into a belt or a cluster, you'll warp into the very center of it, and there'll be asteroids scattered throughout that sometimes can be 60, 70, 80, maybe 100, 150, 200 kilometers out. If you bookmark it and then you warp to that bookmark, cuts down your travel time tremendously. If you plan on doing a very long mining session, you can grab an interceptor or a frigate and warp out to your cluster or asteroid belt and scout out what ores that are available. And if you're good, you can actually pinpoint a very specific location, so where you're in range of a whole bunch of different asteroids, and bookmark that spot to keep yourself from constantly warping to a new bookmark for a new asteroid. Sort of like plotting out your position in advance. What can really help you with this is something called a survey scanner. And I talked a little bit about this before. It's essentially a mod that will scan down the asteroids closest to you. They'll give you info on the range of the asteroid and the amount of ore that is left in the asteroid. This is nice because if you know how much ore your strip miner or miner ones, miner twos, any mining laser takes in a cycle, if you see that there may only be like one, two, three, or four ore units left in that asteroid, you can actually cycle down or cancel click your mining cycle shortly after starting it, so you don't waste that entire time on your cycle just trying to pull in something that may take only 1 or 2 seconds as opposed to like 3 minutes of cycling through the whole duration, if that makes any sense. All right, so since you are mining in Null-Sec, there is one thing you have to worry about, and that's being attacked. It's easy to start panicking and making mistakes if you're being attacked while you're mining, especially if you're in a more expensive ship. So one thing I can say is just stay calm, focused, and act diligently. When you're mining, it's always best to mine aligned to your station or citadel. That way you can quickly warp out if you see enemy pilots coming into your system, or God forbid, you see enemy pilots fly into your asteroids. There's a nice rig that you can buy. It's called a Higgs anchor. What it does is that it lowers your top speed on your ship, allowing you to stay aligned considerably longer. To those of you who are completely new and don't know what aligned means, it's literally pointing your ship towards your destination. It's like if you're pointing your ship towards your citadel or station, it saves you time from having your ship turn around to warp back out, because you have to have your point, you have to have your ship pointed in the direction you're going to warp out. If you mine aligned, it takes a lot less time to warp out, essentially. The Higgs anchor helps in that. It keeps you aligned a lot longer because you're actually moving while you're aligned. It'll actually slow down your moving. An important thing is, if you are being attacked, most definitely put W's in the standing fleet you're in, along with what system you're currently mining in. And whether it's in the same post or in the subsequent post that follows, tell everyone around you what is attacking you or what may be tackling you, scramming you. It's very important to call out if a whole fleet is attacking you, because if you just say, "I'm being attacked," you don't say anything, and somebody warps in, if there's a whole fleet on you, not only have you gotten yourself killed, you've gotten that person that warped to you killed as well. So just say, "I've got a fleet on me." At that point, essentially, you aren't going to get saved. I know that sucks, but better you die than a whole bunch of other people dying, and you dying as well. Also, this may go without saying, if you have your drones out, whether it be your mining drones or your combat drones, just leave them. Don't worry about trying to rake them back in if you're being attacked. Drones are cheap by nature, and unless you're flying like crazy golems or something, Yeah, just leave them. That they aren't going to be the worth the cost of trying to save them if it's going to get your ship blown up. All right, so now if you've gotten to the point where you can actually start flying a mining barge or a exhumer, when you're in Null-Sec, most situations you're going to want to stick to a specific mining barge called a procurer. It's a tank based mining boat. with a bonus to drones, which are really, really handy for miners in Null-Sec. It just kind of goes without saying. They have really, really strong shields, really high health pool. It's about equivalent to that of a battleship, which has a crazy amount of health. And since it does have a bonus to drones, it's actually really good for clearing out rats that fly into your belts. And sometimes, depending on what they're flying, it may even take out some enemy capsuleers if they're flying frigates or whatnot. The Tech 2 version, or the Exhumer version of the Procure, is called a Skiff. It's even tankier, much more expensive, and I think it has a little bit better bonus with drones. I could be wrong, though. But it goes all without saying, the golden rule of EVE is don't fly what you can't buy. If you can't buy the ship you're flying to replace it, don't even bother flying it. The other mining barges and exhumers that are available, there's retrievers or Mackinaws. Mackinaws are the Tech 2 version. They excel at automation in that they have really, really large ore holds, and you can mine a lot longer with them without warping back to your station. Unfortunately, they have a very, very weak tank. They're somewhat easy to kill. There's another one called Culvertors, or Hulks are the Tech 2 equivalent. These are cool in that they have really, really high mining yields. They mine a lot in a very short amount of time. They have a rather small ore hold. They have the smallest ore hold amongst all the mining barges and exhumers. And they have a very weak tank. They're very, very easy to blow up. Personally, myself, I actually fly Procure, and I always have at least one or two mods equipped in my low slots called Warp Core Stabilizers. What Warp Core Stabs are, they keep you from being tackled. They keep enemy players from scramming you and preventing you from warping off. Not to get too involved with what Warp Core Strength is and all that. Essentially, they add more strength to your warp drive, preventing people from tackling you. Now, if you have a lot of people tackling you, it's not going to help you. If you have like three or four ships scramming you, you're still going to stay locked down. But if it's like one ship, and you've got one warp core on or two warp cores on, warp core stabs, you can warp out to safety. One drawback behind equipping a warp core stab is that it actually reduces the locking range of your ship, and the speed, the locking speed too, forcing you just to stick closer to your asteroid that you're mining from. You have to be in a closer proximity to it. All right, once you've gotten your skills up, you've actually graduated to the point you can use the Tech 2 version of strip miners, which are the mining barge and exhumer version of miners. You can use something called a modulated strip miner. It's essentially a strip miner that has ammo, and that ammo is crystals. These crystals, they allow you to mine a lot more ore, but the crystals themselves, they're geared specifically to one type of ore. So, like, for example, Arcanore. If you have a modulated strip miner too, you'll have to have something called a Arcanore mining crystal to mine Arcanore and get the effect, or the bonus effect, of having that charge. To use crystals, you need to skill into reprocessing, which I've included in the skill book package and the ventures I've handed out. To get to a point where you can use these crystals, you need to level reprocessing to 4, and then another skill called reprocessing efficiency to 4 or 5, depending on what type of crystal you want to use, and metallurgy to 4. And then you begin training into the ore specific skills. There's actually a skill you have to train into for that particular type of ore. Like, again, for example, you have to train into Arcan ore mining or Arcan ore reprocessing to be able to use the Arcan ore crystal for the mod strip miner. You should, you know, kind of map out and know in advance what you'll be mining as you're training your skills so that you efficiently train into the skills you need to mine those certain types of ores. Or to say it differently, if you know you're going to be mining Arcan ore, Bistot, train into Arcan ore, Bistot, mining or refining efficiency. I know that kind of goes without saying, but it's just worth calling out. One thing to note, these crystals, they do act as ammo, and they also degrade over use. One thing to be incredibly wary of is the fact that you can sell people degraded mining crystals, which just makes them less of any worth to anybody. And the best way to tell if a crystal is degraded is that it can't stack on top of another crystal. Or to say it differently, if you've got fresh crystals, you can stack them. If a crystal's been used at all, if it has any amount of degradation to it, you can't stack them. So if somebody tries to sell you a whole bunch of crystals, whether it be in a contract or what have you, and they aren't stacked or they don't have multiple stacks of it, there's probably a good chance it's a degraded mining crystal. In which case, don't buy it. Murkoxit, that rare mining crystal I was talking about before, it is a bit of a special snowflake in that if you want to be able to mine it using, or actually if you want to be able to mine it at all, you have to use a modulated strip miner referred to specifically as a modulated deep core strip miner. It's used specifically to mine Murkoxit. You can't mine it with a regular mod strip miner. And the deep core mod strip miner actually mines at a much slower rate than the others. So that's one thing to keep in mind when you're mining Murkoxit. You aren't going to mine it nearly as fast as the other Null-Sec cores. All right, so combat mining. So if we're at war, and as of right now, we are, on occasion, we may be asked to actually contribute to the war effort via something called combat mining. Combat mining is where we go into a system that we already control and or wish to defend it and raise the ADMs, or active defense multiplier. ADMs determine how long it takes to entosis a system, which entosis means nothing more than taking the system. You can actually learn more about entosising through another presentation by a guy named Slanik. It's also available in Flight School. But for the sake of this presentation, I won't be going over it to save time, because it does take a little bit of explaining. So while you're mining, if you're being called to do some combat mining, who go into a system and actively raise the industry index in that system, making it harder to take. In order to be effective at combat mining, you just simply need to mine, and mine a lot. The industry index will increase based on the sheer amount of volume being mined in that system over a certain set amount of time. So even mining something as simple as Veldspar, like the base ore in the game, it helps tremendously. So, please note that while you're in a system with some activity, you can expect to encounter some hostiles while you're combat mining. It's best to fly something cheap and easy to replace. And it's always good to just keep your head on a swivel. Check local, check intel, check standing fleet. If somebody says something, you know, just be wary of it. All right, I think I've talked long enough. I apologize if it's a bit of a boring presentation, but honestly, it's kind of comparable to mining, so it's appropriate. If anybody has any questions right now, I'd be happy to answer them.
Now, I asked a question on the little question thing, and I don't remember seeing an answer. Is there a place to get this information written down, you know, like the ships, you know, and suggested mods and that sort of thing?
There's a few different resources. It's just a matter of checking online. I do cover a little bit about it in those earlier slides. But once you do get into things like mining barges and exhumers, it's all kind of dependent on playstyle. Really, not a whole lot changes between the shift from a mining frigate to a mining barge, other than the fact that you may want to, or not may, you definitely will want to use strip miners instead of mining lasers. And you may want to start using warp core stabs in your low slots just to keep yourself from getting tackled. Beyond that, it's just all dependent on what type of mining barge you're flying. Like if you're flying a Procure, you definitely want to throw some shield hardeners on there because it is a shield tank ship. Some of the other stuff like the Coveter, the Mining Hulks, Mining Retrievers, stuff like that. It's just all very dependent on what type of setting you're mining in.
Okay. Nick, another question is GME's quite possibly going away. What's going to be the new place for mining?
Can't quite remember it off the top of my head. I'd have to go check .land. 99% of the time, where you're mining or where we want people to mine will be the lowest security status system. Once we do, actually, if at some point we do win this war, we'll be moving out to Tribute, and the Constellation we'll be moving into has, I believe, a few negative 0.7 systems, and I think one negative 0.8 system. So I'm assuming we'll want to be mining in the negative 0.8 system, based solely on the fact that I think we actually get 10% variant minerals or variant asteroids once we hit negative 0.8. But I don't speak on behalf of the Horde Directorate. I'm not 100% sure where we'll want to be mining. So just keep that in mind. Can't quite remember the name of the system, though. I apologize. I had to pull up .land to figure that out.
No problem. Thank you for the class.
Oh, no problem. No problem at all. Are there any other questions if anybody's still awake? I know I'm not the most lively talker.
One question here about reprocessing the ores. Say I want to run my own industry, so I'm got into mining my own minerals as well. Does it make more sense just do it myself or get someone else to do it?
A bunch of people in this corp will probably tell you, and myself included, if you're getting into industry, the aspect of mining, you'll want somebody else to do that for you. Or to say it differently, if you're doing industry and you're making money, just to save your time, it's best just to buy your resources as opposed to actually gathering yourself. Now, some people are going to tell you, you know, hey, it's cheaper just to mine your own minerals and use that, depending on what type of setup you have. If you have a bunch of alts and you're a fan of multi-boxing, you know, you may want to consider that. Have one alt mining while you're doing or a few alts mining rather, while you have one tune doing a industry, you know. But I think a majority of people will tell you people who do industry want to stick to doing industry and not mining. Have somebody else do the mining for you.
No, that's fair enough.
Any other questions?
Yeah, why do a lot of feedings I've looked for the Procurer show only one strip miner?
Some of you are new, and I'm assuming you've just joined the game here recently, not too long ago, I take it. A few weeks ago, actually, it may not have been a few weeks ago, it may have only been a week or two ago, There was an update to the game that sort of rehauled the mining barges and exhumers. Prior to that update, the procurer only had one high slot, or only enough room for one strip miner. After that update, all the ships, including the retrievers and coveters, got condensed down so that everybody had two high slots. So if you do see some fittings in the corp settings that only have one high slot strip miner, just note that you can actually put two in. I don't think we have any corp settings for fitting like the Hulk or I can't remember the Tech One version. I can't remember if it's Retriever or Coveter.
Coveter.
They used to have three high slots. That actually got taken back down to two. So if you do see a fitting that had three high slot strip miners, then just keep in mind that it's actually two at this point. One thing I didn't cover earlier, I kind of want to actively avoid covering it because it is more for advanced players and advanced miners. But in the upcoming November update, we're going to see a rehaul on some of our large industrial mining ships, the Orca and the Rorqual. And they're actually going to include a small industrial ship called a Porpoise. These are actually going to play a little bit more of a role later on in that two things are going to happen to them. A, they're actually going to be really good at mining. They're going to be able to take in a lot of ore, when otherwise, as of right now, they don't take in any ore. They just offer bonuses or boosts. And two, their boosts have to be on grid with you. Or to say it differently, they just have to be next to your ship or within the same vicinity of your ship. So you actually start to see some of these large industrial ships like the Orca and the Rorqual in the same belts or cluster as you, depending on if people are actually brave enough to take some of those big ships out in Null-Sec and risk them. But one of the things coming up with the Rorqual in particular, it's actually the largest industrial mining ship in the game at this point. It's going to receive a unique mod called the Panic Mod. It's an acronym for something really long and drawn out. It's like something Nexus and Vulnerability something. The Rorqual is going to have this ability to actually make all the mining ships in a belt invulnerable for a short amount of time if they get attacked. It sucks in that you can't mine, I don't think. I don't think you can mine while you're being invulnerable, and you can't move while you're being invulnerable. The whole point behind it is that if you do get swarmed in and a fleet jumps you, somebody's in a war call near you, they can hit the panic button and make everybody invulnerable long enough for some groups to come and help you.
From what I read, you will be able to continue mining.
Oh, okay. Well, that's cool.
But you won't be able to move at all. But you'll be, and you'll be in vulnerable. So is that the only way that Horde plans on protecting the mining fleet, or will there be dedicated combat ships go out with the mining fleets when we have the command ships out in belts?
It's kind of up in the air at this point. A few people have been talking about offering some active defense ops, or active mining ops rather, with access to the defense fleet. People pulling out their Rorquals and getting a few bros together to clear out some belt. Not 100% sure if that's actually going to go through. It just all depends entirely on somebody's willing to risk sending out their Rorqual to a belt. Because they are kind of expensive. And like I said, this unique mod that the Rorqual's getting, this panic mod, it does make you invulnerable for a short amount of time, but once that invulnerability field is down, it leaves the Rorqual very susceptible. And I don't know the going rate on Rorqual's at the moment. I think it's like 2 or 3 bill. That's an awful lot in asset to leave exposed.
Has Horde talked all about actually producing and providing those command ships to FCs that it's less of a risk to the player and Corp takes on more of that liability?
For the roar calls, no. Now, the new porpoise that's getting introduced to the game, which is like a very small combat, or I'm sorry, a very small mining booster, I think, don't quote me on this, but I think we are actually going to have a plan in place to produce those and sell them to people. I don't know how many. I don't know how, if we are even actually going to go through with it, but it is in the talks at the moment. More than likely, you'll just have better luck buying it from somebody who's producing them purely to make a profit, as opposed to getting it from the corporation. And same goes for orcas and oracles too. I mean, those are crazy expensive ships. And as of this point, I wouldn't promise on Horde producing a SRP for those ships. So just keep that in mind. Now, having said that, from what I read through the patch notes, Oracle is actually going to have the mining efficiency of like 5 or 6 exhumers, and that's a lot. So they may be able to just pay themselves off for an extended amount of time. If you mine for about 2-3 days, you can just buy another Oracle.
I had a question about ice refining.
Sure, shoot.
So, Noah was thinking about, you know, fuel for his Rorqual, so he had said about the heavy water and stuff. So I got some ice from KLY, so, but there's no place close by which I know for ice refining. And I have very low skills as such.
I'll be honest, I think for ice refining, I don't do much ice mining because it is kind of a little bit less profitable. But I assume some of the refining mods that are installed in citadels or are quote unquote refining citadels increase ice refining. I could be wrong. That may be worth looking into. Or to say it differently, we should have some citadels in some of our systems that are labeled refinery. And they're essentially that. They have refining modules installed in their in the citadel itself that increase.
Yeah, and especially with all these rotors and entosis mollas all requiring ice stuff, so you know, it'd be important to have some refining with of ice around you.
Yeah. Now I can tell you our corporation actually buys a lot of its ice from trade hubs like JITA. But I'm sure if you're willing to want to set up a program where you sort of produce an ice sellback to the Horde, that might be something you may want to talk to a director about. I'm sure somebody might be interested. I don't know. I'll say this. I mean, ice is crazy cheap right now. Crazy, crazy cheap. But like you said, some of the caps getting boosts and or changes in this upcoming patch, ice might be go up in price quite a bit because it'll be used more often.
Yeah, the only reason I got into it because Noah was buying it at twice the JITA rate, so that's why.
No.
So can command towers be used to possibly protect the mining fleet? I don't know exactly how the command towers were.
No. Right now, we have some ships that boost, like Royal Cross and Orcas, both. Some of them may be parked in some of our towers or passes. But come November, to receive those boosts, they have to actually be on grid with you, or to say it differently, they have to be in the same vicinity as you.
Right. So could the command tower be moved to the mining field where it could provide some kind of protection for the miners?
No. Command towers themselves, I think they have to be anchored, I think, 1,000 kilometers away from any other structure. whether it be anomaly or belt. And one thing that sucks about that is that I believe belts and anomalies both move when they get reset. So if you set up a POS, that POS, or let me take a step back and say, even if you could set up a POS next to an asteroid belt or cluster, it's only going to last you for a few days before the belt moves after reset.
I got a question. Should you do jet canning if you're going solo, like you don't have a hauler ult?
Depends. If you want a jet can mine, you'll definitely need to have a hauling ship, whether it be an alt or just using your same character, have that ship docked up in the nearby station and then fly back out to your jet can when you fill it up. But like I said, the drawbacks on jet can mining are a bit extreme in that anybody can take anything from your jet can, and it takes literally just one shot from anything to blow up your jet can and it loses all the stuff within it. If you want to like go crazy on mining, and if the system that you're mining in has been safe for the past few days, or if you feel like it's going to be safe for the next few hours, and you trust our fellow Horde bros to some extent, which I do, I mean, I'll admit I do jet can mine, then yeah, definitely go for it, because it will increase your efficiency. I mean, you will be able to sit down and park your mining ship next to an asteroid for a lot longer and rake in those ores quicker. But it's just definitely worth renoting the drawbacks on jet can mining.
Let's say you're using a broker and have combat drones. Could a solo ganker still kill you or not?
If you're in a procure and somebody in a small frigate, like let's just say a rifter, pops into your belt, and you've got some decent medium drone operation skills, and maybe you decide to equip a drone damage amplifier on your proc, maybe. Maybe you can kill him. That is
so
a bit
in
of
general,
extreme.
If any neutral pops to your belt, you should just warp off.
Sometimes, I mean, if you play long enough, if you know what you can take on, if you can gauge it appropriately, and like I said, if you have some decent drone skills, then some people just say fuck it, they'll pop the dude that came into their belt. Especially people have been like consistently harassing other people in a system. Like we used to have a few people, like I can't remember his name. In GME, we had a guy named Concentration. He used to fly an Astro at one point, and if you were lucky, you caught him and locked him up to keep him from stealthing. You can sick your drones after him and kill him. I've done that a few times myself. But like I said, it's all very dependent on the situation. If you have a cruiser come into your belt, yeah, you want to warp off. If you have somebody in a battleship or something like that, or if you have a whole fleet of people coming into you, yeah, you'll definitely want to warp off. And you'll definitely want to leave your drones sitting out. I mean, unless they're orbiting you, don't try and rake them back into your drone bay, because that will get you killed. One other thing to note, I didn't cover this in the presentation. So rats are things that pop up in your belts or your anomalies, over time. I think there's like an internal 10 to 15 minute timer when somebody warps into a belt or an anomaly before rats will spawn. There is a chance for a dreadnought or Titan rat to spawn. If you don't know what a dreadnought or Titan is, it's literally one of the biggest ships in the game and the most damage dealing ships in the game. And there are rat versions of it. And if they spawn into your belt or anomaly, you want to warp off as quickly as humanly possible, because they not only will scram you, more than likely they'll either one-shot you or two-shot you with their ships. So it's always best to keep your head on the swivel, make sure when you see rats pop into your system, or pop into your belt rather, make sure what they are. If you see something pop up like Serpentis Titan or Serpentis Dreadnought, you want to warp out as quick as possible.
Are there fixed waves of rats? I mean, I've seen this, like, there would be usually a battleship and a couple of frigates would show up. You kill them and you come back. A few minutes later, a second wave of those similar things will show up. So is there a pattern to it?
No, not really. Not in belts and anomalies. I have consistently seen, like, if I log in a certain time of the day and I know nobody's been in a particular anomaly, if I was like a fresh warp into, you know, I'll see a few small frigates and a cruiser rat show up, and then maybe 10 minutes later I see one battleship show up, and then maybe 10 minutes later I'll see three battleships show up. But I can't honestly say 100% of the time that's going to be the case. I don't know for sure if CCP has like a some kind of formula to gauge what rats need to spawn in after a certain amount of time. But I do know there is a percentage chance of a Dreadnought or a Titan rat spawning in your system. And it's always best to just be aware and be ready to warp out at a moment's notice. Because I think you only have like 12 seconds to warp out before they scram you. And then after that, you're pretty much screwed.
Can you tell me something about mining gas and wormholes? Because I was thinking of giving Honor a trip, going to the J whatever system and mining some gas once in a while. So what can you tell me about that?
Well, I'm not too terribly familiar with gas mining. I don't do it myself just because I kind of make a habit to stay out of wormholes. I don't find wormholes fun. But essentially it's just like mining, except with a wormhole mindset, in that you go and find a gas site, start raking in your stuff. Don't chat in local, make sure you bookmark your in and out gates. And keep your head on a swivel even more so in a wormhole system as opposed to a null-sec system. Beyond that, I think the biggest challenge is that once you do get your wormhole gas mined up, it's just getting it out of the wormhole and to whether it be your industry alt or a market or something, you know. That's what kind of makes gas so lucrative, because it's exceptionally hard to move.
The whole bros do have a buyback on their station, so you don't have to haul it if you
use the
on our program.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I did not know that.
Can you answer a question about industry in the 7RM system? Do you know anything about it?
I can maybe help answer that question. If I can definitely direct you to somebody.
Okay, I was just wondering, where is it the best to do research and manufacturing? Like, there's F&M system, and then there's the station that says don't dock here. And you can do research, manufacturing, and refining in either of those, but I'm not sure which one is the better.
I'm pretty positive a lot of people are going to tell you to just go to F-Tech End to do all of it. Not 100% sure are what the bonuses or rates are in the kickout station in 7RM, but just so some of you will know, in case you don't know already, 7RM has a station called the kickout station, in that it's a station that when you leave it, it actually puts you outside of the docking range, which leaves you susceptible to a whole bunch of things. If there's somebody camping our system, they might be camping the undock on that station. And if you undock, you are going to be screwed. So yeah. Now, I mean, I do know people do some of their industry stuff there, just because I think it does have some bonuses, and it is in the same system as 7RM. But
let's say you manufacture ships, and you don't have a freighter, so you'd have to move the ships one by one from FNM to Beanstar to sell them. Or if you do it in the kickout station, then it's much easier to move the ships.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, it is much easier, but you are bringing on a lot of extra risk. So that's kind of the trade-off. I can tell you, if you are moving ships one by one, depending on what kind of ships you're producing, I can tell you, you definitely want to start skilling into industrial haulers. You don't necessarily need to have a freighter, a capital freighter, to move stuff. Like, for example, I set up all these newbie ventures that I've been handing out to people. I produce them in ITECU, which is all the way out in the GME pocket, and then just haul them back in two trips with a Kaldari hauler called Ataria. And I think I made 30 total. So, I mean, it just all depends on the volume that you're producing. If you're making 100 or so ships, then yeah, it would be handy to have a freighter. But if you're moving them one by one, then I'd definitely say start investing in some of your industrial hauling skills. In which case, you can then resort to producing an FTEC in, which is a safer system. And again, I'm not 100% on what the bonuses are between FTEC in and the kickout station 7RM. But obviously, if you're getting heavy into that, keep in mind, though, that I'm not sure if it's going to be the November update or if CCP is pushing it to spring. But at some point, we'll be getting something called industrial arrays, which are essentially industrial citadels that have much, much, much bigger bonuses to industry than what's available right now in stations and passes. And it's kind of being developed in the same scheme as citadels. There's going to be three different sizes. There's going to be a small, medium, and large version, kind of similar to our Astra House small, Fortizar medium, and Beanstar. I'm sorry, Keepstar large. So, not 100% sure what the Horde has planned for that, but I'm assuming we will be producing something in that regard. And I think they have the same setup as Citadel's currently in game. You can tether to an industrial array and be invulnerable and all that jazz.